Hello and welcome to my presentation titled The Good Student or the Good Patient, the barriers encountered by undergraduate medical students with disabilities at the Northern Ontario School of Medicine. My name is Rachel Boulanger and I'm a student in the Interdisciplinary Health Program at Laurentian University. Before I begin, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge my supervisor, Dr. Elizabeth Levine, as well as my committee members, Kate Beattie, Dr. Jason Schack, and Dr. Diana Urachnik. To begin, I'd like to define the term disability more clearly. A disability is an impairment leading to limitations or restrictions occurring in day-to-day life and refers to a wide range of impairments that include but are not limited to physical, sensory, motor, neurological, psychological, and learning disabilities lasting 6 months or longer. In 2017, 22.3% of Canadians 15 and older reported having a disability. When it comes to students with disabilities, these numbers are lower, and the rate of self-reporting is close to 11.5% for undergraduate students, yet falls to an average of 4.6% for medical students. It's necessary to question why this drop occurs, but in part, a lack of knowledge about disabilities leads to the formation of negative attitudes and stigmatization, potential reasons for why there is the underreporting of disabilities among medical students. While Canada does not have the equivalent to the Americans with Disabilities Act, Ontario has the AODA, the Accessibility for Ontarians with Disabilities Act. Such laws promote the inclusivity and diversity of individuals with disabilities, ensuring that their disability is not the sole reason for exclusion from any number of activities, and establishes a standard for the implementation of accommodation for students and employees throughout Ontario. Ultimately, a lack of understanding about these policies and their resulting discord among those enforcing the law, professors, disability personnel, and students leads to barriers for students requiring academic accommodation. The American Association of Medical Colleges released the Lived Experience Report in 2018 with hopes of broadening the diversity of medical students to include more of those with disabilities, with the goal of ensuring all those qualified to learn medicine have the opportunity to do so. The authors generated discussion and studied the lived experiences of current medical students, residents, and practicing physicians with disabilities. In the words of Desmond Tutu, inclusive, good quality education is a foundation for dynamic and equitable societies. In an age where we place great focus on inclusive education, more research is required on the inclusion of students with disabilities in undergraduate medical education. At the Northern Ontario School of Medicine, inclusiveness is not only one of the school's main values, but an academic principle. In response to the Lived Experience Report, we replicated a part of this study with the research question, "What are the barriers encountered by undergraduate medical students with disabilities at the Northern Ontario School of Medicine?" We hoped to identify barriers and challenges unique to learning and having clinical placements in Northern Ontario and rural settings, as well as the academic accommodation process. We expected many of these barriers to be similar to those identified by the Lived Experience Report, but predicted there would be some unique experiences to NOSM students as a result of the rural and northern communities in which they learn and practice. As a result, we explored the climate and culture at NOSM and how this affects the treatment and education of students with disabilities. This brings us to research methods and design. For this research, a qualitative descriptive study design was used. As noted by Bradshaw and colleagues, qualitative descriptive research provides a vehicle for the voices of those experiencing the phenomena of interest, and we hoped to provide a voice to the participants in this research to learn about the barriers they've encountered. We began recruiting participants using a purposive method of sampling to include undergraduate medical students with disabilities at NOSM. We intended to include 12 participants with a wide range of disabilities and a goal of saturation of data. Participants were recruited using posters shared through social media using Facebook, as well as through NOSM's Learner Affairs letter and email sent to students from this office. Data was collected using an initial demographics-based survey, followed by a semi-structured interview, which was adapted with permission from the Lived Experience Report. Following the interview, data was manually transcribed and Brown and Clark's thematic analysis was applied. This six-phase approach is used to focus on the meaning across a dataset, and themes are generated from transcriptions to make sense of collective or shared meanings of an experience. This brings us to the results and discussion section. In the end, 4 participants were recruited. There were 3 female participants and 1 male participant. Each of the participants had a different type of disability. Below are profiles of the participants using their chosen pseudonym, highlighting similarities and differences between them. Katie, Natalie, Daniel, and Penelope were our participants. Katie, Natalie, and Daniel developed their disabilities in high school, while Penelope developed her disability just before beginning medical school. Natalie, Katie, and Penelope had formally disclosed their disability to the medical school through Learner's Affairs and obtained accommodations, while Daniel informally disclosed his disability to preceptors in clinical settings when needed and did not use accommodations. The barriers that were identified by the participants fell into three overarching categories, which were barriers directly associated with medical education, barriers indirectly associated with medical education, being invisible disabilities and social barriers, and other barriers, such as how their disability has impacted their journey in medicine and barriers outside of medical school. When it comes to barriers associated with medical education, it affected students in several ways, many of which had to do with seeking accommodations. When seeking accommodations for clinical placements, Katie encountered a lot of resistance. She said, "I just felt like I was being judged, asking for help." Not only does this directly associate with her medical education, but reflects the stigma in medicine and self-stigmatization that individuals develop. This also affected Natalie when discussing accommodations for her OSCE exam, and was told that the exam had to be fair for all students. She said, "I'll never be at everyone else's level, so this isn't about equality, it's about equity, and it just made that made me so frustrated." Each of the participants spoke to the fact that in many ways, their disabilities were invisible, and they didn't necessarily look like they had anything wrong with them. Penelope spoke to one of the challenges of this, saying, "I feel like when you have an invisible disability, you almost second-guess how severe it is, because again, you can't just measure it." And social barriers affected students both in their personal lives and their education. Natalie said, "Even sometimes just in class, like I would sit in the front, and I would be by myself, like two seats empty, whereas everyone else was crammed, and like I could see that as a little bit isolating. I can't assume that it was because of my disability, but it's kind of a thought in the back of my head, in my mind." For the participants, their disabilities also affected their journeys in medicine. For Katie, it ultimately drove her into medicine, and she said, "I never always wanted to be a doctor. It was just being an inpatient at the hospital, learning about the roles of the physicians and just realizing how important it is as a patient." Participants also encountered barriers in their day-to-day lives outside of medical school. For Penelope, she was unable to do many of her hobbies and noted that, "And so, I can't really do the things that I love, which is physical activity or reading, because those are the two hard things, but I'm trying to be a little more creative." We found that overall, our findings supported those of the lived experience report. We noticed that social barriers was a theme that stood out in both studies, and these barriers emerged in several types of environments. We also found that in both studies, it was found that there was a lack of clear policies and procedures accessible to students, faculty, and administration, leading to confusion and miscommunication. Surprisingly, structural barriers did not present themselves in this study, but it was a barrier that was identified in the lived experience report. Additionally, while we expected there to be barriers unique to learning and having clinical placements in Northern Ontario, this did not present itself in our study. When creating suggestions for future research, we'd hope to broaden the scope of this research study by recruiting a larger sample size, and this may have to be done by considering recruiting students with disabilities from various medical schools in Ontario and even Canada because of the small sample population. We'd also like to implement a longitudinal study to look at the barriers that medical students with disabilities face as they transition into different roles, to consider the impact these changes have on their personal lives and careers. There are also several implications and recommendations based on the results of this research. Importantly, we hoped to empower medical students with disabilities by providing them with a voice and allowing them to share their experiences. Moving forward, we recommend that NOSM reviews their accommodation and accessibility policies periodically and to use clear language to reduce confusion and to prevent miscommunication. We also recommend that NOSM include students with disabilities in this process and include more than one student due to the unique challenges that students with disabilities that differ face. Finally, we recommend that NOSM establishes clear communication between the medical school, host universities, and host communities when organizing clinical placements for students with disabilities. There are also limitations. The greatest limitation to this research was the small sample size, in part due to the small sample population, challenges in recruitment, and different types of bias. There were several sources of potential bias present. First off, selection bias was possible due to the small sample population and challenges in recruitment. Non-response bias may have occurred due to fear of revealing undisclosed disabilities, And similarly, membership bias may have prevented the participation of medical students with disabilities, as they are a stigmatized minority in medicine. Additionally, there was a potential for researcher bias, as the student researcher was an outsider from the sample population and an able-bodied individual. This brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening.